linger on. Your pale blue eyes.
Welcome back, everyone. This is week 4 of Film Adaptation, and this week we're turning to Julian Schnabel's The Diving Bell and the Butterfly. This film is an utterly unique experiment with cinematography, and director of photography Janusz Kamiński's work is going to be a special focus of this video. We'll perform a sequence analysis of the film's opening shots and then move around the film a bit more to explore some of its experiments with the camera body as a stand-in for both the protagonist and us as viewers. Our keyword for this week is enable. And we'll consider how the limits of the film camera, as well as those of our narrator, Jean-Dominique Bobby, are turned to account in this film. We're talking about cinematography, which means we'll examine qualities of the shot, including framing, camera movement, camera speed, masking with the iris shots that we see in this film and other kind of blockage of the camera's field of vision. We'll discuss depth of field, including shallow and deep focus, and we'll look at some of the really tricky tricks that Kamiński comes up with, including tilt-shift lensing. These are technical terms. In our discussion together, we're going to apply some of these technical terms to more theoretical ends. And I want in particular to explore the concepts of suture and haptic visuality. So how does a film pull us in, and how does a film touch us? We're going to explore those questions together. This week's film was directed by Julian Schnabel, whose film career has been marked by a pretty persistent concern. He's interested in depicting the lives and the process of the artist. His films express his artistic kinship. He's a very renowned painter himself, with the struggling artist. He's making biopics, which has to be my least favorite mode of film. But I do love what Schnabel does with the biopic. He stresses the bio in that biopic, telling stories not just about lives, but of artist bodies. From Basquiat, the young street artist discovered by Andy Warhol and his struggles with depression and addiction, to Before Night Falls, which tells the story of Cuban poet Reynaldo Arenas, who was persecuted for homosexuality. The Diving Bell and the Butterfly, adapted from the memoir of Jean-Dominique Bobby, tells the story of art's saving power. Bobby, a one-time editor-in-chief of Elle magazine in France, and one of the most famous patients to suffer from locked-in syndrome, is going to be our protagonist in this story. This rare neurological disorder, locked-in syndrome, is most commonly caused by a stroke or brain injury. Unlike vegetative patients, whose consciousness is so grossly impaired that the individual is incapable of voluntary or purposeful acts, locked-in patients are still cognitively and consciously aware of their environment. Thus, they're seen as trapped in their own bodies. Bobby's memoir, written using an elaborate eye-blinking system, was published in France on the 6th of March, 1997. Bobby died suddenly from pneumonia just 3 days after the French publication. Go looking for his memoir in our library, and you'll find it under RC, Internal Medicine. As uncommon as locked-in syndrome is, rarer still is the chance to hold expressive communication with a sufferer. A year before his death, Bobby would help found the Association de Locked-In Syndrome, another heroic act of externalization, of communication, another refusal of the exile that this condition would impose upon him. This is autobiography, but with none of the autonomy that that term suggests, the automatic, spontaneous nature of writing your own story. All that is deeply complicated by Bobby's condition. His memoirs give the account of his experience with this condition through the one channel of physical communication left to him, the determined flutter of his left eyelid. Each letter in the text that we read has been signaled through a coded sequence of blinks, an act of profound narrative struggle and negotiation with his team of therapists that risks being glossed over by readers. In his prologue, Jeandot describes the pace of his new life in confinement and the measured movement of his gaze. I linger over every item. Do we, as readers, linger with our narrator, pausing after every character, marveling over its construction, the physical work that's being thrown into each letter? It's not likely, because literacy is a kind of mobility. We speed over that obstacle course that Bobby is forced to crawl through. On page 30, the written text allows us a taste of what happens when language is slowed to such a crawl. What opens up? A kind of poetry of misreading. The gap between lune and lunette prompts Bobby's visitor to ask what I wanted to do with the moon. But this is a rare moment in which our narrator plays hangman with us as readers. For us, the labor of transcribing that code has already been accomplished. The gap between letters, between lune and lunette, disappears, a little like the frame between film cells. The relentless momentum of reading and viewing cranks stillness into movement. Bobby's text doesn't make us work through the process of communication, the mistakes, the frustration, the uncertainty. As readers, we're only handed the stunning end result, a product that can't help but obscure the profound difficulty of that process. Yeah. Inevitably, this labor of writing is effaced by the ease of our reading. The book, it might be said with some irony, is a pleasurable and quick read. The film's intervention, then, lies in closing this ironic distance between the felt experiences of the artist and of the audience. The book describes Bobby's frustration, while the film dares to induce it. This shared experience is catalyzed by what has to be the most extraordinary use of literal first-person perspective in the history of cinema. It's a sustained experiment in intensive vision that persists over one-third of the film and immerses us in Bobby's physical experience. Schnabel's film doubles the voice of Bobby's memoir to generate a much more immediate sense of Bobby's frustration. We're familiar, of course, with the technique of voiceover, which often provides viewers with privileged access to the depth of a character's mental subjectivity through interior monologue. But how would you describe this film's treatment of voice?
Maintenant, essayez de dire votre nom.
Jean-Dominique Bobby.
Allez, essayez.
Je voulais...
Essayez vraiment.
Quoi?
Dites-moi votre nom.
Jean-Dominique Bobby.
Essayez de dire les prénoms de vos enfants.
It's not a typical voiceover. It's not thought made audible, but a voice rendered inaudible. We are silent witnesses to this sound that generates unbearable dramatic ironies, as well as frequent inside jokes. Let's take a look at how our bodies are grafted into the film in its opening scenes. Following the opening credits, the film falls into about 10 seconds of darkness. We emerge slowly, with an iris in. The iris shot, staple of early cinema, hinges on a central analogy of film, that of the camera eye. A circular mask is placed over the frame to produce a rough analogy between human perception and the camera's vision. This camera is an eye that facilitates our vicarious visual experience. Of course, this is a very unconventional treatment of that familiar gesture that we're seeing in this film. As the screenplay denotes, the camera is Jean Doe. And this body is not your average or normal body, which means that this picture isn't fated to be an average or normal film. This different kind of body presents an opportunity for a different kind of cinematography. And I love how Janusz Kamiński describes this technical and phenomenological challenge. This is Kamiński speaking with Movie Maker magazine. Our character has impaired vision, and he's coming out of unconsciousness. He fantasizes and has flashbacks, and he's using his imagination to survive. All this creates tremendous visual opportunities. While fantasies and flashbacks gesture to the limitless possibilities of cinematic escapism, Kamiński's first point on impairment suggests that the visual possibilities of film can lie precisely in its limitations. So Kamiński recognizes impairment as an opportunity. He's grasped a surprising irony of Bobby's condition. Bobby's disability aligns perfectly with the cinema's abilities. His vital, vibrant body is in lockdown. His channel of communication with the sensuous world has been reduced to that tiny little window. But how perfect for filmgoers that it's the eye. The film experiments with a range of ingenious in-camera effects, from the blur of tilt-shift lensing to lens flare and shallow depth of field that highlight the physicality and the limits of Bobby's new vision. Each channels the abstract and disembodied concept of perspective through a literal lens-based simulation of seeing through Bobby's eyeball. Kamiński relies primarily on practical effects, using the camera body and his own body, and those are the camera operators, to represent the singularity of Bobby's vision in the moment. For instance, the blink that composes Bobby's written memoir will also give shape to the film, and that's an effect that Kamiński creates simply by closing his thumb and index finger in front of the lens. Focus is a technique that the cinematographer can use to direct the viewer's attention, but also for expressive purposes. The classic example of deep focus is provided by Orson Welles' Citizen Kane, in the scene where the fate of the young Charles is being decided by a number of adults with varying degrees of authority. When we shoot in deep focus, as Greg Tolland is doing here, we keep the foreground, the middle ground, and the background simultaneously in acceptably sharp focus. That's what deep focus does. But what can it mean? Well, this style really emerges as an aesthetic, but also an ethic of film modernism. Orson Welles, Jean Renoir, Kenji Mizoguchi all believe that this technique is best suited to the representation of reality because it implicitly challenges any individual perspective and focus. It holds objects of mise-en-scène in balance and the perspectives of different agents in tension. In so doing, it signals a breadth of perspective.
Harry, I'm asking you for the last time. Anybody think I hadn't been a good husband?
A sum of $50,000 a year is to be paid to you and Mr. Kane as long as you both live, and thereafter to the survivor.
Well, let's hope it's all for the best.
It is.
Is shallow focus short-sighted, then? Well, we might say that its focus is selective. Its depth of field is restricted. This choice directs or guides our vision with intention. It's a technique that's typically used to emphasize one part of the image over another. And this selective focus is often used to communicate psychological introspection. What we see in Diving Bell's opening, however, isn't so much about commanding the viewer's perspective, but demonstrating the lack of visual control that Bobby experiences. How is Kaminsky producing these chaotic images, which seem to simulate Bobby's wandering eye, roving around the room, pulling tiny objects into focus when it can? It's worth pausing here to admit that I don't know. In this class, you're being asked to perform visual analysis, which involves practicing reflective observation and trying to name what you see with some precision. You'll find that you don't always already possess the right words or technical language to do that. So look it up. That's what I did, and here's what I found. Kaminsky could have done something quite basic here, a little bit like the blink in front of the camera. He could be hand-holding the lens in front of the camera mount and twisting it around. That's called lens whacking. Another option, which seems to have been his method, would be to use a tilt-shift lens. Really cool camera tool that's worth examining in a quick tutorial.
So here I've got the 17 millimeter tilt-shift, and it's got various knobs and dials on it. So I'll start with this one, which is the tilt function. So as I turn this wheel here, you can see that the lens itself is actually bending pretty much right down the middle. Now what this is doing is changing my plane of focus. What do I mean by plane of focus exactly? Well, if I'm using just a normal lens, not a tilt shift, and I focus on my subject, everything that's in the foreground and in the background is going to be blurry, assuming that I'm shooting with a short depth of field. What the tilt shift does is it actually can angle your plane of focus. So now, instead of things being out of focus front and back, they're out of focus side to side. So the next dial on this lens is the shifting function. Now, it's this knob on the side, which you can also rotate. And instead of bending the lens, it actually shifts the lens up and down. And what this function does is it can either eliminate or exaggerate perspective. Another great application of the shift function is, for example, if you're shooting something and you want to be straight on, but there's either something in your way or you don't want to be too obtrusive, and so you're forced to shoot on an angle, you can actually turn your shift dial and make it look like you are shooting straight on, even if you're not.
Whatever the technical method, Kaminsky is abandoning here the mechanisms of the camera that typically would allow him to frame, focus, and control the world of images that surrounds him. We often get the sense we're drowning in the light of this world as the aperture fills up with the glare and flare of excessive illumination that overwhelms the eye and distorts the image. The frustration of our conventional desire to have the camera exert visual control over the world it views is compounded by Schnabel's use of extreme close-ups. What is the effect of this technique? How does it feel to us as viewers? We're denied the distance that frames visual pleasure, the space that's necessary to gain an objective perspective on objects, and maybe even give us a feeling of power over what we see. Laura Mulvey names this desire to turn people into images so we can enjoy them as objects as scopophilia. We might say that this was Bobby's job as editor of fashion and lifestyle magazine Elle. But here, the gaze of the camera is immobilized. Camera operators for this film spent much of the shoot in Bobby's wheelchair and his hospital bed. Locked down in this manner, the camera takes in our surroundings in awkward, canted angles. Camera distance is out of our control as well. We can't withdraw or retreat from the image or from the other. We're held in uncomfortable intimacy with eyes, with bodies that impose themselves on us, that obstruct our perspective. These extreme close-ups encompass the narrow parameters of Bobby's field of vision, and they prompt us to consider such scenes as examples of Eisensteinian framing. Eisenstein is bored with the neutral and supposedly natural way that frames center on objects. He's more interested in compositional conflict, depicting objects that resist being boxed in by that frame. In this case, conflict arises from being anchored in Bobby's position. Like him, ours is a body now under observation, at the mercy of these bodies looming in the frame, even the stubble that glints and grates at the lens seeming to invade our personal space. At such close range, bodies produce intense effects, some breathtakingly intimate, others callously indifferent. Schnabel employs this unusually and often uncomfortably direct address to explore the collapse of camera distance as an ethical problem, as an erotic possibility, and as a phobic prohibition. Conventional framing sees the camera tracking the movements of characters. Here, those caring for Bobby find that they instead have to incline themselves to the frame. During Céline's first visit, played by Emmanuel Singer, Dr. Lepage, Patrick Chenet, demonstrates how she must orient herself in order to properly interact with her ex-husband. Bobby's fixed perspective makes camera distance and framing ethical concerns. In films that deploy a disembodied gaze, this ethical relation between seer and seen can be forgotten easily enough. Against that numbing aesthetic, though, Kaminsky's work in Diving Bell works to sensitize viewers, just as Dr. Lepage instructs Céline to the power of our position and the meaning of our gaze. We feel in an embodied way that characters who overwhelm or even fail to recognize the frame, thus placing themselves outside of Bobby's visual field, they fail in some essential sense to recognize Bobby's own humanity. So, while we might appreciate the experimental approach that Kaminsky takes on an aesthetic level, it's not just a work of impressionistic abstraction. I guess you could call this an art film, but what prevents it from becoming a piece of abstract art? For critic Michael Koretsky, it's the spectacle of the fragility of the body, one that we get to experience from the inside out. That's what grounds this film's style. In Koretsky's words, it's artifice without detachment. So those experimental framings, lensings, and movements don't just make pretty pictures. They bring us closer into sympathetic alignment with this body. Bobby's memoir provided a critique of how disability is represented, how it's treated inside medical institutions and within broader society. But his story is more important for showing us how his body represents, how it makes its own meaning. Kaminsky's camera, in its turn, demonstrates that an impaired and reconfigured body is not an obstruction to artful and humane expression, but a vibrant and creative filter.
If you close the door, just turn off the light.